Distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen, I am coming here from Bangladesh representing the Liberation War Museum, a private museum established in 1996 to commemorate and memorialize the atrocities that our people went through in 1971, one of the brutal genocide of the 20th century, and also the suffering and the resistance they have organized and established their own nation state. And we have a very checkered political history after that, and the Bangladesh genocide was very much in the focus of world media in 1971, but it was very easily forgotten after that. And there was no call for justice, no accusation against the perpetrators, and also in our country, it was very difficult also to organize everything because of the political changes and the military regime which took power. So on the 25th anniversary, the museum was established and it started the process of memorialization. And it was greatly inspired by a people's tribunal, which was established in 1990 by the, as the name shows, by the civil society movement, and which has inspired the younger generation very much. And so we are a continuation of this process of justice and memory, and the museum has grown over the years. Now we have a permanent house, we have many different facilities, and we can think of many different kind of work. And at that time, the Rohingya genocide, the last crisis which erupted in August, and the refugees started pouring in Bangladesh. And we have a center for the study of genocide and justice, which is working for the right of justice for our people. And ultimately, in 2008, in the national election, the voters have overwhelmingly supported the cause of justice, and a tribunal was established, and we are working very closely with the tribunal. And we have a group of young volunteers. We are also engaged with the international genocide scholars. And when the Rohingya crisis erupted, we thought that we are engaging the younger generation, and they are doing the theoretical work on genocide, its legality, the issue of trial process, the evidences, and how to establish justice, transitional justice, restitution, rehabilitation, all these things that related with the justice process. But then the victims came to our country, which is a victim of genocide. And we find it really interesting that the government of Bangladesh has extended their support to the survivors who came to Bangladesh and tried to do whatever they can for their shelter, for their also, the people also overwhelmingly stood behind our government. And we found that the 1971 experience, when we were victim of genocide, and also 10 million of our people had to leave the country and seek refuge in India, and they were given support by the Indian government and people, and with the end of victory, they came back. And this memory actually survived in the public consciousness. And that's how the Bangladesh has extended its support. But when we talk about it, we should keep in mind that we are the victims of genocide, and we extended our support to our neighbor who has become victims of the similar atrocities. So this is a historical link, which I think has a lot to learn from it. And then we engaged our young, we have a legal volunteers team. We organized different courses, offers winter school, and we organized so far 5 international conferences with the international scholars. So we have a large number of volunteers, and we engage them to go to the camps and meet with the survivors. And this is we can call it a rare opportunity, but it's also a very tragic opportunity that you come face to face with the survivors or victims of genocide. So what we have done is in September, they went to the camp. And in October, we published this Testimony of 60. This has followed the pattern of Testimony of 60, which was published by Oxfam in 1971 with the testimony of important world leaders like Mother Teresa, Edward Kennedy, and others, and also victims from the different camps. So we followed the same pattern and did it on the persecution of Rohingyas in Myanmar. And we also sent our volunteers to the to collect testimony of the survivors. And they did a first research report, which is the persecution of Rohingyas in Myanmar, genocidal intent and its manifestation. So they looked it from the legal perspective, and with the support of our legal experts, they did a report. Then we found that there are a lot of victims of sexual violence. I think Razia today has made a very powerful presentation. And we also found that we should especially focus on the victims of sexual violence. And a second team went in the early February, and they took testimony of about 54 victims. And we worked it in collaboration with the Bangladesh National Human Rights Commission, and also from a legal point of view. So when the case will come up for the trial in any court of justice, this can be used as a testimony. So they have taken the record with the permission of the survivors. They have taken with them an interpreter who could then support the statement that has been transcribed. Also, they have with them a PTSD expert, so that it's very difficult to take the testimonies of the victims of sexual violence. So the preliminary report has been prepared, and we think that we will also come up soon with this report. Now, these are a few things that we can do, the list that we can do for the victims of genocide of our neighboring country, with whom we have a long relationship. And when we look into it, we find that our struggle was for a multicultural society based on our ethnic national identity. And it is the same struggle which is the Rohingya people are launching, that they have a long history and they want their right to recognition of their national rights. And it is said that in Bangladesh, we always say that the state is new, established in 1971, but the civilization is ancient. It is same with Burma, same with the Rohingya, and Bengal has a very interesting relationship with the Kingdom of Arakan. One of the greatest Bengali scholars, Abdul Karim Sahitya Bisharad, he collected ancient manuscripts, and he found that in the Kingdom of Arakan in the Middle Ages, when in Delhi it was the Kingdom of Alauddin Khilji, and in the Arakan Strait, the king was at one time took shelter in Bengal, then he was supported by the Bengal king, and when he went back to Arakan, he also invited Bengali scholars to be in the kingdom. And Bengali literature survived, and one of the greatest manifestations of Bengali literature was made in the Arakan kingdom. And also today, it's a very interesting thing that the whole India is now very much engaged in debate on a film, very popular film, Padmavati. And our South Indian friends will know Deepika Padukone, very popular actress. She acted in the film. And the BJP, the rightists, they say that this film is tarnishing the image of the Hindu kingdom. So it is a very strong debate going on. And the story of Padmavati was written by Malik Muhammad Jaisi. He is a middle-aged poet. And this story is a love story which goes beyond the religious division. And Padmavati was translated into Bengali by one poet who was the poet laureate in the Kingdom of Arakan, Alaul. He is very much respected in Bengal. So these are the historical things which has a great link with each other, with the commonality of the people. And also there are trade links, there are other links. In Dhaka, we have a place which is called Mok Bazar. The mocks are chakmas, and also some of them came from this Kingdom of Arakan. So historically, there's no denial that every society is multicultural, multi-religious, and we have to learn to live with that. And I think that's that the historical lesson we have learned in 1971, and that's the spirit that we want to support for the Rohingya people. And also as the legal framework we are studying, and Raphael Lemkin, when we developed the concept of genocide, one of the basic premise was that it is the destruction of the nation, not only the victim nation, but also the perpetrators. They destroy themselves because they create a society which they want to impose their own ideology on a society and eliminate the diversity, which has happened with the German society, with the Nazi philosophy, which has happened with the Pakistani state philosophy and the atrocities that followed, and which is happening now with the mainstream Burmese society. But Burma is a great country, land of ancient civilization, and we are hopeful that our struggle has also been victorious in spite of a lot of obstacles, and Rohingya people also will win their rights, and we will be there with them in whatever way we can. Thank you.
Thank you very much.